what is the solution that allows the very large groups that simply seem unalterably opposed to the Assad government, and the reality that the Assad government does control, you know, maybe 12 million people?
Let me first of all say that our policy with regard to Syria, as well as Iraq and Afghanistan and elsewhere in the region, has been consistent. We oppose terrorism, we oppose extremism, and we come to the support and aid of governments who continue to support extremism and terrorism. We did that in Afghanistan in the early part of the century, when we were vehemently opposed to the Taliban and Al-Qaeda government. We came to the support of the Iraqis, both in Erbil and in Baghdad, in order to prevent an ISIS takeover. We're doing the same in Syria. As far as a...
You do not regard any of those forces fighting the Assad government as legitimate opposition forces?
There may be legitimate opposition forces in Syria, and that is why in 2013, a few weeks after I assumed office as the foreign minister of Iran, I presented a four-point plan, which later became the basis for Resolution 2254 of the Security Council. Those 4 points are, in order to be realistic and in order to move forward rather than to get bogged down in an unnecessary debate that will only prolong the conflict and will only prolong the killing and pushing people into homelessness, we need to get real and get to the bottom of it. First, a ceasefire. I believe we need a ceasefire. We always need a ceasefire. People put conditions upon ceasefire, but it is clear that we all need to engage in efforts to bring about a comprehensive ceasefire, except obviously against those groups that are considered by the Security Council as terrorist organizations, which would include ISIS and al-Nusra. Second part of our plan, and of course with ceasefire comes humanitarian assistance, which is absolutely imperative. The situation is disastrous in Syria, and people from both sides are suffering, and it is important to bring about humanitarian
assistance. And then political, some kind of...
No, the second part was a national unity government, a government that would include the current government as well as those opposition people who are concerned about the future of Syria and who want to participate in a better future for Syria. The third part of our plan was constitutional reform, so that the powers of the government will not be concentrated in one office, in one institution. Power would be so dispersed that people would feel that they have a part of the stake in the future of Syria, and that would bring everybody in a non-zero-sum situation, because usually you will not be able to resolve zero-sum games. Zero-sum games end up producing negative outcomes. So you need to...
And then elections.
And then elections based on that constitution.
What is the chance of this happening?
I think it's the basis of Security Council Resolution 2254. People should stop putting conditionalities for the Syrians. We need to allow the Syrians to make that decision. If people believe that the current government is unacceptable to the Syrian people, they should insist that the elections should be free and fair. And then as the outcome of the election, people who are running the government right now will not be re-elected. The point also is that it all depends on the constitutional reform. If the constitutional reform removes all the power from one office, you may not need even be concerned about who is the president, because you will have other officers in the government who will be responsible.
I got to ask you about so many other Yemen.